Let us pray. Us. Thank you, Lord, for this amazing day. Thank you for this house where we gather together. And you've called us to this place. I don't believe it's a coincidence. Here we are in this place because you've called us to be here in your presence with each other. It's amazing, Lord, what you've done for us. It's amazing the greatness of who you are, Lord, how great thou art. And when I think that God, his son not sparing, sent him to die, I scarce can take it in. God, thank you for Jesus. We're all the richer for it, Lord, because of your great sacrifice. It cost you everything, God. It cost you everything. I pray that we would never treat that cheaply. That inside of our hearts it would ring true. Oh, God, who am I that you are mindful of me? But you are mindful of me, and you gave Jesus for that. If it were just me, Lord, if it were just me, you would have sent Jesus. Dear God, I pray that you'll bless those people who are called mothers here in this place today. Lord, I pray that you will bless them real special. And Lord, I pray for those souls that maybe today isn't such a grand day. Maybe for some, mom isn't even necessarily a comforting word. And maybe for some, maybe mom's gone and it's just plain painful and it just plain hurts. God, would you just gather us all together in this place and help us to know that on this day, we're all so important to you. And no matter what our lot is in life, Lord, you've called us by name, each one. And you've called us to special purpose. I pray, Lord, for those mothers who are calling on the name of Christ this morning, that, Lord, you will use them greatly inside of their houses, that, Lord, you will anoint them, use them, let your blessing rest upon them, let them know that they have an awesome job that you've given to them. And, Lord, I pray that you'll just bless them with the ability, with the wisdom, with the counsel of God in all that they do. Thank you for mothers, Lord. I pray, Lord, that you will bless those yet again who are sick and ailing. They're not feeling well. God, I believe that you are the God of healing. I believe that you're more than able, Lord, for those who are sick and ailing and needing your helping. Jesus, I thank you that there's nothing so small that we can't come to you with it. And God, whatever the cares are in this room right now, Lord, that we can just place that before you. And Lord, that you will touch that very thing. There's nothing insignificant to you about us, Lord, because we're very significant to you. Jesus didn't die for something that's worthless. He died for something that was worth everything. God, would you please help us to remember that? And God, I just pray that you'll bless this morning with your great blessing. Help us to know, Lord, that we're not worthless. We're not insignificant. We have so much purpose, so much value, so much worth in your eyes that you thought we were worth dying for. And exactly the article of who we are is exactly what you needed us to be for your purposes. Help us not to second guess, Lord, what it is that you've done and what you've called us to be. Have complete right of way today, Lord. Hide Brian behind the cross and use him greatly, Lord. Let your word come through. In Jesus' name we do pray. Amen.
Well, I thank you. Hello again, everyone. I did one more quick announcement. I forgot to mention that per the manual, we have to announce it 2 weeks in advance that we are having church elections next Sunday. Okay, so for all of you who are members of this local house, next Sunday morning between, during Sunday school hour in that time, there will be a table set up before and during that section. So make sure you come and cast your vote and have your voice be heard. And I just want to encourage you, these elections are, to the outside, it may seem like not a big deal, but it is a big deal. It's a big deal in-house in our local church because This is establishing boards of leadership and people who oversee the flock. You know, the pastor of the church may be called to be the shepherd of the flock, but we have a team of people that serve this house and that serve you guys, and so that matters. And so these coming into these elections with a heart of prayer and a heart of discernment of the people that are in leadership of this house is important. So I just want to bring that to your attention again. Next Sunday, if you're a member of this church, you have the entitlement to vote. So come on out and vote and be heard, okay? Well, it is Mother's Day. And again, I thank you for all the moms in the house today and for all the moms watching online today. Thank you so much for joining with us. We want you to know we love you and appreciate you. And I think Mother's Day is an important day on the calendar because I don't know how much you pay attention to your news feed or watch the news altogether, but motherhood is something that's come under attack in this country. I'm going to be a commentator for just a moment, so I'll speak now and apologize later, okay? make y'all uncomfortable for a moment. The position of our culture currently is that pretty much anyone can become a mother, okay? If you're a biological male and you decide that you want to be a female, you can become a mother. If you are born a biological female with a uterus and decide that you want to become a male, you too can become a mother, right? And so obviously people on the opposite side of these issues vehemently disagree with that, and the back and forth is almost like a war. Certainly it's become political, you know, which largely one side of the aisle will argue one side of this discussion and the other side will claim the other position, and again, back and forth and back and forth. And what we're witnessing in our country right now is people on both sides of the cultural issues of the day treating each other with the least amount of respect possible. A public display is being made in our nation for the rest of the world to watch and to witness. This is how we treat other people created in the image of God. There's a void of decency in the message and voice of our culture. There's an abundant supply of people talking over each other, interrupting one another, smashing each other with our words. Listening is on the decline. Most people never seek understanding. Grabbing the spotlight is what's in vogue, and shouting and biting and attacking have become our national language, it seems. That's the culture we live in. Sadly, that has infiltrated God's church. And so the question becomes, as we're in the final week of this series, we're talking about living boldly and confidently to proclaim the message of Jesus Christ. How do we, the people of God, stand boldly in moments like these? Well, I can tell you, it's certainly not by being louder. It's certainly not by taking the microphone away from someone else and speaking over them, of cranking up the volume, because that's already being done. I believe that it's by waking up and understanding that I am not beholden to any amount of groupthink. I am not beholden to any political party. I am beholden and belong to the King. And my King, Jesus, helps me to form my opinions, helps me to form my beliefs and to make decisions about my life and how I treat other people. I was not saved by a political party. I was saved by the blood of the Lamb. I'm not beholden to anybody's agenda. I'm a child of the King. And as a child of the King, I have a higher calling. And so my hope today in this message is not to affect any massive sense of global change. That's for sure. Okay? My hope today is that somebody here, somebody in this room, somebody maybe watching online today who hears the word of God will say, I want to be different. And in deciding that you want to be different, not your family, not your group of friends, not your coworkers. I'm not talking about what happens in my office building or at my school, even in my neighborhood, that somebody today would say, Lord, change me. I want to be different. And not only do I want to be different, then I want to leave this place and I want to treat one person differently. If each one of us did that, to say, Lord, change me into the image of Jesus and walk out of here and treat one person differently, we're going to affect a massive amount of change in our world. Because I believe the loudest voice of all is the voice called love. And that's what the world is missing in this moment. We have plenty of division. We have enough people voicing hatred and voicing stereotypes and voicing racism and voicing attack. We already have enough of all that noise. And the way I believe the church cuts through this noise is to voice the love of God to the people of this world. That's how you cut through the noise. Your Bible's with you. I want to invite you to join me in 1 John chapter 4 today. 1 John chapter 4, it's a small book towards the end of your Bible. And I want to read pretty much the whole text if I can today. And then I want to lift up a few, I would say, obvious points. And I know for me, sometimes the obvious is what I need to hear, not stuff that I've never, ever thought about for. Amen? So 1 John chapter 4, if you found it, say word. Anybody? If you need a minute, say hold up. All right. It's 1 John chapter 4. I'm going to begin at verse 7 if you'd like to follow along with me. Dear friends, let us love one another, for love comes from God. Everyone who loves has been born of God and knows God. Whoever does not love does not know God, because God is love. This is how God showed his love among us. He sent his one and only Son into the world that we might live through him. This is love. Not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son as an atoning sacrifice for our sins. Dear friends, since God so loved us, we also ought to love one another. No one has ever seen God, but if we love one another, God lives in us, and his love is made complete in us. We know that we live in him and he in us because he has given us of his Spirit. And we have seen and testify that the Father has sent his Son to be the Savior of the world. If anyone acknowledges that Jesus is the Son of God, God lives in him and he in God. And so we know and rely on the love God has for us. God is love. Whoever lives in love lives in God and God in him. In this way, love is made complete among us so that we will have confidence on the day of judgment, because in this world we are like him. There is no fear in love, but perfect love drives out fear, because fear has to do with punishment. The one who fears is not made perfect in love. We love because he first loved us. If anyone says, I love God, listen, yet hates his brother, he's a liar. For anyone who does not love his brother, whom he has seen, cannot love God, whom he has not seen. And he has given us this command: whoever loves God must also love his brother. That's the word of the Lord this morning. Thanks be to God. A couple of highlights from the text I want to lift out. Number one, that love is the calling card of the kingdom of God. If you're a note taker, love is the calling card of the kingdom of God. Now hang in there with me for a minute if you're thinking on a broader level today. The thing that distinguishes you and me as being a part of this kingdom, the kingdom of Jesus Christ, is love. It's the thing that sets us apart. The most well-quoted verse in all of Scripture, I would say, is, for God so loved the world that he sent his one and only Son, that whosoever should believe in him should not perish, yet have everlasting life. John 3:16. Your neighbor who never comes to church probably knows that verse. The heartbeat of the kingdom that we're a part of is the love of God. For God so loved the world that he sent his Son. The way that we are distinguished as brothers and sisters of faith, Jesus said, is by this love. John 13:34, a new command I give you, to love one another. As I have loved you, so you must now love one another. And by this, everyone will know that you are my disciples if you love one another. In other words, the world is not going to know that we are followers of Jesus by our opinions. They're not going to know we're followers of Jesus by the fact that we gather together or what building we come to. The world is going to know, oh, you must be one of those followers of Jesus by A, the way that we love each other, and B, by the way that love spills over then out of our relationships with one another to the world around us. The heartbeat of our faith is love. The way that we are distinguished among people, Jesus says, is love. And in Galatians 5, it says the fruit of the Holy Spirit is love. We see Galatians 5:22 shows us this picture of the fruit of the Holy Spirit. And the very first thing on that list is what? The fruit of the Spirit is love. So we're in this kingdom that is originated in love. We are to be known by that love in the world. And we're filled with this Holy Spirit who produces that kind of love as a natural byproduct, a natural fruit in the life of the believer. So listen, when people see attacking, people who are hating, people who are stereotyping, people who are living that type of life and exhibiting that type of behavior, you know the Holy Spirit is not in that type of behavior. Because the fruit of the Spirit in the life of the believer is love. It's the calling card of the kingdom of God. The second thing that I see in this text that's powerful is that the cross is the epitome of love. The cross is the epitome of love. It's a self-sacrificing kind of love. It's not just an emotional love. It's not of, I really like that love, or that's one of my favorite things love. We throw that around in our culture, though. I love that. That's not love. Okay? The epitome of this love that we're talking about today is a self-sacrificing love. That's the love of Jesus Christ. In John chapter 15, it says this. Verse 9, as the Father has loved me, so have I loved you. Now remain in my love. If you can keep my commands, you'll remain in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commands and remain in his love. I have told you this so that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be complete. My command is this. These are the words of Jesus. My command is this. Love each other as I have loved you. Greater love has no one than this, to lay down one's life for his friends. You are my friends if you do what I command. I no longer call you servants, because a servant does not know his master's business. Instead, I called you friends, for everything that I learned from my Father, I have made known to you. You did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you so that you might go and bear fruit. Fruit that will last. What is that fruit? It's the love, right? So that whatever you ask in my name, the Father will give you. This is my command. Listen to how succinct this is. This is my command. Love each other. In other words, seek a self-sacrificing love toward the people around you, and you will be then living as sons and daughters of the kingdom of God. The third thing that lifts up from this text in 1 John is that we reflect what we receive. We reflect what we receive. We are incapable of doing what Jesus is asking us to do unless we go back to the first commandment, right? To love your neighbor as you love yourself. In other words, if I haven't heard and I have not received the love of God, there is no way then that I'm going to be able to reflect that to the people around me. It's impossible. Now, I can try to love other people. Right? I can even say that I love other people. There are a lot of people in our culture, and it looks like they're loving everybody. They're supporting everybody. They're advocating for everybody. They're encouraging everybody and being nice to everybody. But at the end of the day, if you peel back the layers of that, there's always an agenda. There's always an agenda. People do what they do so they can get the approval that they so desperately need by being someone who loves everybody around them, supports everybody around them, advocates for somebody around them. In many cases, it's I don't really feel good about myself. And so in advocating for and supporting and seemingly loving everyone, my hope is, in the end, that that same support and advocacy and love is returned to me. That's a picture of our culture. That isn't self-sacrificing, Jesus-motivated, Spirit-inspired love. Jesus' kind of love is a love that speaks over us and drowns out every other opinion of our lives. Growing up, we were blessed enough as a family to have tickets to the Browns, Cleveland Browns games. And so my brothers and I got to go, my mom got to go. We could go down and watch the football games, okay? And I could tell you, if you've ever been down to a football game among 60, 70,000 people, when it is loud, it is loud. It's rocking, and that sound drowns out other things going on. And so there would be times when the stadium was just pounding, everyone's on their feet, and you would literally yell to my dad, like, and he's like, what? You'd yell, what? You could not hear each other because the sound drowns out everything else that's going on around you. That is the relationship we want with God. I want the voice of God and His love over my life to drown out every other opinion, every other voice, all the stuff that I look to that makes me think or makes me feel like I'm important. I want the voice of Jesus over my life so when the world comes shouting, I'm like, what? I can't, whether it's good or bad, I can't make out what you're saying. Because the voice of love, the voice of Jesus, is proclaiming His love over my life. When we receive that, I mean, you fully receive that and get your hands on it and absorb it and process it, then and only then can we reflect it to the world around us. See, I think that a lot of the disdain we have for people, and even in the church it's there, okay? Let's be real today. It's simply a reflection of the fact that we don't feel fully valued in the love of Almighty God. And so maybe today, that's the starting point for you. For somebody here today, it's not necessarily how you're treating other people, but maybe it's letting the Father treat you in a certain way. Maybe that's not how you've been raised. Maybe you didn't come up in an environment of where you were loved and appreciated and valued with dignity and respect. But God Almighty is a perfect Father, and He wants you to know today you have value. He wants you to know today that you have dignity, you have respect, you have worth. So much so that He is willing to offer a self-sacrificing love for you. See, it's not, the message of the gospel is not, I'll die on the cross for you if you'll serve me. I'll die on the cross for you if you'll accept me or worship me or give money to the church or fulfill some purpose that I have in your life. No, it was Christ saying, you're worth everything to me, and I'll die on the cross for you whether you follow me or not. That's the message of the gospel. That's value, friends. That's worth. That's the voice of the kingdom and the voice of the King over your life, the voice of love. Can I just say to you today that there's nothing that disrespects God more than for me to look to the world to speak over my life, to voice over my life what the life, death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus has already spoken. We reflect what we receive. See, if you're brought up in a punching culture, you're probably a puncher. If you were brought up in a culture that said, I'm going to tear you down to lift me up, you're probably a champion criticizer. You're probably really adept at pointing out the weakness in somebody else. But I want to tell you today that Jesus can change that. He can change that heart. You can say goodbye to the influence, whatever it is that you came up under, your parents, your grandparents, whatever cultural influence you were shaped under, you can say, no longer am I beholden to what anybody else has to say, anybody else's mindset, anybody else's stereotypes or opinions. I'm a son or a daughter of the King. And I'm a recipient of the greatest grace that's ever been given to mankind. And I want to be a part of that. I want to be part of that brand new kingdom. That's who I'm beholden to. And the message of that kingdom, friends, is the voice of love. The fourth thing I want to lift up, this is where the tension point of the story is, okay? Because I want to say that I want to be guided by love, but that doesn't mean that I want to vaporize truth. Okay? Love and truth go hand in hand. This is where the tension comes in, because, again, the message of our culture is, I'm just going to love everybody and everybody gets a free pass and you can do what you want and say what you want and think how you want, treat people how you want, and you know what? I love you anyway, brother. Okay. So you can treat me however you want. You stole from our business. You went behind the back of the board. You took all the money. But you know, I'm part of this new kingdom. I love you. No, that's where the gospel works on a different level. That's where you say, you know what, I do love you and I do forgive you for the way that you've treated me and hurt me terribly, but there needs to be some boundaries in our relationship now. I do forgive you for stealing from our company and for what you've done, and I do love you and I forgive you, but now there's some consequences. You're going to have to go in front of the court and make amends for what you've done, right? I'm not going to try to destroy your life, but you are going to be held accountable for your actions. Love and truth go hand in hand. This is what Scripture says in Ephesians chapter 4. Instead, speaking the truth in love, we will grow to become, in every respect, the mature body of Him who is the head, that is, Christ. A little bit later in the passage, it says, to get rid of all bitterness, all rage and anger, all brawling and slander with every form of malice. Be kind and compassionate to one another, forgiving each other, just as in Christ God forgave you. But it says that we do that speaking the truth in love. Okay? What it says in John chapter 1 about Jesus is that when he came, he was full of grace. And everybody loves that. And he's full of truth. In other words, grace and truth aren't mutually exclusive, are they? Love and truth aren't exclusive. They go hand in hand. Parents in the room will understand this, right? That love and truth go hand in hand. How many, you don't need to raise your hands. How many parents ever had your child tell you they hate you? Actually, let's go ahead and raise your hands. Let's feel bad together, okay? No, it's already 10 p.m. It's already 10 o'clock. It's dark outside. You cannot walk to your friends whose parents are not there because a bunch of kids are gathering there together and you're all spending the night. No, I hate you. When you said no to your child, you did not give up your right to love them. And if you and I want to love the world, we need to hold on to this value that love and truth can live together in this same economy. Okay? Look, just because God loves you doesn't mean that he agrees with you. Amen? God doesn't love you because he sees eye to eye with you on everything. He loves you and me because he created us. We bear his image. So in the same way, I don't need to agree with you to love you. I can love you, speaking for me, right? Because you're a person of great worth to God, even if we disagree. See, the Bible says that love overcomes a multitude of sins. In other words, it puts me in this perspective where I don't first see you based on your actions or your activity. I first see you as a person created in the image of the same God who created me. This is why, to me, racism is one of the most heinous, sinful stains on the fabric of humanity. Because at our core, we're all created in the image of God. I was talking to Kurt this morning, and he mentioned this phrase, "How dare you disrespect the workmanship of God?" Our dignity originates in our createdness before Almighty God. So my approach then, as a follower of Jesus to people in the world is you're special. You're precious. You're valuable. You have dignity. And we don't have to look the same. We have to think the same. We don't have to agree on politics or cultural preferences or issues for me to love you, because you're lovable. Because you're valuable to the creator of the universe. And because God loves you, I love you too. Now, that's not easy. In fact, as we said before, we reflect what we receive. If you haven't received that love of God and been changed by the love of God, it's darn near impossible to live that way. And where it's going to break down for us, certainly outside the church, but even inside the church, is if we start equivocating, if you disagree with me, then you must not love me. Right? Heard that one before? Every relationship breaks down at that point. What do you mean you disagree with me? Then you obviously don't love me. That's the voice, the loudest voice in our culture right now. Those things don't cancel each other out, friend. Not necessarily, right? They never have for any parent. They never have in any close relationship where people love each other, even when there are differences. Because as the people of Jesus, we are guided by love. And we may have extraordinary differences, but that doesn't certainly mean that I need to hate you or even dislike you. Why? Because love and truth can go hand in hand. We're guided by love. And that allows us to see people as people, right? Not as religions or cultures or ethnicities or gender or by what they've done or what they believe, but to see them as people created in the image of God. And friends, the church must be the voice in culture that says, I may not agree with you, but I just want you to know that I see you and I value you. And I love you as a person created in the image of God. You're beautiful, you're valuable, and you're lovable to God, and I'm going to treat you as such. And the last thing, and I'll close it with this, is that the kind of love that God is asking us to be bold and to be confident to proclaim to the world is a kind of love that works itself out in action. And that's what I want to call us to today. Now, I should have probably said this at the beginning. I just want to say thank you. Thank you to who you guys are, PCN. Because I'm sure that that somebody comes to worship here and they are annoying and they are bigoted and they do stereotype people and they are racist and all those things. But if you're here, I don't know who you are. What I know, the people of PCN, you are a church that exhibiting this kind of life of following the King, this kind of heartbeat of following the King, and especially the kind of heartbeat that works itself out in action and loving other people. So as your pastor, I want to say thank you. This is what Paul says in Galatians chapter 5. For in Christ Jesus, neither circumcision nor uncircumcision has any value. He's saying there's not this kind of religious practice or that kind of religious practice that we champion, right, that makes any difference, that has any value. The only thing that counts, listen to this phrase, the only thing that counts in this new gospel economy is faith expressing itself through love. 1 John chapter 3 says this in verse 16, this is how we know what love is. Jesus Christ laid down his life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for our brothers and sisters. So what does that mean? To lay down your life for someone else. Right? We tend to think, like you hear that, something heroic. Okay? And certainly it is, but I think to lay down one's life for other people means to open our hearts to the needs of the people around us. It involves like practical, concrete acts of love in the everyday, ordinary matters of life. This word ought that Paul uses here in the original language, it points to a regular, ongoing, even daily obligation in our duty to love other people. We ought to, he says. We are called to love the people we see, as Kierkegaard puts it. Not just the people we like, or not just the people we choose to, But even the people we disagree with, even the people that we dislike who are around us, especially the people who are in need. And so, as the church of Jesus, we need to be in thought and prayer about this. What does this look like in my life? What does it look like for you to lay down your life for others in your workplace? In the schools, kids. In your neighborhood, in your own family. Even here in the context of the body of Christ. What does it look like to lay your life down for others in the church? Can I just encourage you today, if you see an area where you think something can be better, let's have some conversations with people. Okay? And let's seek to understand and contribute and serve where we're able to make things better. Let's start proclaiming that God's people are the hands and the feet, literally. Right? We show up, we get involved, we serve in the power and the love of God's Holy Spirit to change relationships, to change neighborhoods, to change workplaces, to change families in Jesus' name and through His love. That's what the church does. Okay? And it doesn't mean you can't have an opinion. We all have them. Okay? We all have opinions, and there are times we need to speak up. But man, we need to shut down the idea that I need to make my opinions known. Because anybody can be critical. But it takes a special person to say, I don't need to share my opinion, but I do need you to hear somebody else's opinion. I have something you really need to hear. And the people of God, we are the medium for the voice of the King. And the message that Jesus has for our friends, our neighbors, our co-workers is, I love you. That's what He wants to say to our city. You're created in beauty. You're created with a purpose. You're created in value and dignity and worth. You're created in the image of Almighty God, so much so that the King Himself would come and stretch out His arms and give His life so you could be forgiven of sin, welcomed into the family of God, brought from death to life, filled with His Spirit, changed by the Word of God to become fully the person you were created to be. So that you then can proclaim that love to somebody else. The same love you received, you can reflect it to somebody else, that they too have worth and value and dignity in the eyes of God. This is what the world needs to hear. And I believe it's this voice, this message, this voice of love, it's going to cut through the noise of our culture. When we say, I am not beholden to be a hater. I belong to the King. And yes, He's full of truth. But He's also full of grace. And His calling card is love. And because of that, my calling card is love. And so I'm going to love the people around me just as He has loved me. Amen. Would you stand with me? Heavenly Father, we thank You today for this day. It's the day of You have made, and we're going to rejoice and be glad in it. And so, Father, we just thank You for joining with us here. We thank You for Your word. We thank You for all these individuals and families and this community gathered here to seek after You. And I just pray that as You met us here and Your Spirit is stirred in the hearts of Your people, that we were prompted to change and You would find us willing to change. That any area of life, any relationship of life, any point of view we have that is not just bathed in the Holy Spirit, that we are willing to allow You to transform, Father, make it so in us. Make us submit, allow us to have that mindset where we say, I'm going to submit myself to God. I'm going to lay this down at Your feet. Because I want to live as a servant of this kingdom of God, where I love people like You love people, with the value and dignity and worth that they have in the eyes of God. And it doesn't mean I agree with them. I may vehemently disagree with their position, but I can still treat them with love. I may not be friends with them, but I can still show them dignity and value and worth. And I may not give them my opinion because that's not what they really need. They need the voice of love to drown out every other thing in their life that they might know they are loved and valued as a child of Almighty God, created in His image. Lord, shape us into that people to look like Your Son Jesus, that we would take that message to the world. And we ask it all in the name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. Happy Mother's Day again. Again, ladies, please take a gift on your way out. We're so grateful that you're here today. Have a wonderful week in the Lord. God bless you all. We'll see you again real soon.